drinking dark whiskey, telling white lies. One leads to another on a Saturday night. And don't you cross your heart unless you hope to die. Drinking dark whiskey, telling white lies.
Hey, welcome back. You're with Behind the Label. I'm Lowell. I'm from Elgrave Photography.
And I'm Jerry with Stone Fences Tours, and we are, you know, excited to be here with Mr. Stephen Beam of Limestone Branch, and thank you very much for having us here. I mean, it's you've done, besides having us here, I mean, you came to the Rippey Mansion and did one of our bourbon sessions, mm-hmm. which actually was our last bourbon session, with COVID going on.
Yeah, right before everything
broke. Yeah, out. That was in February, and you actually brought in the biggest crowd for them.
Oh.
Yeah, so I mean, they really appreciate, I know the Rippies, they want to say thank you, they really appreciated that.
Oh, it was great to be with them. You know, it's really nice to connect to families who are, you know, getting in touch with their roots like mm-hmm. we did, you know, and have done, and to bring those back, because it's really special. You know, and I know what that means.
Oh, I'm sure you and Mr. Rippey probably could talk for days about bourbon history. I know I've gleaned a lot off of him, just talking to him and stuff, especially about Lawrenceburg bourbon history. So that was great. But your history, the Beam history, I'm from Eastern Kentucky, and we talk about family trees, and our family trees are more, I'd say, briar bushes.
Right.
I mean, the Beams, I mean, your family was involved. If you name a distillery, there was probably a Beam at it.
Probably a Beam there.
Yeah, yeah. You know, most of the larger ones, yeah. After Prohibition especially. Because
mm-hmm.
Joe and his seven sons, and then my grandfather was kind of included in that mix as well.
Mm-hmm.
After Prohibition really were instrumental in bringing the bourbon business back to life here in Kentucky.
Yeah, and one thing I love about coming here, I've been coming here for quite a while now, is that you all talk about the history. You go to some places, there's some places I love going, but they don't talk about their history. That's one thing you all reinforce as soon as you come in. Even not, you know, not just the Beams, but you know, there's a pretty other famous family you're associated with, the Dance. But we love that you incorporate that so people learn that. So I mean, you've got all this background of all this history. So what made you decide to like carry that on?
Well, that is one of the reasons why, because I wasn't fortunate enough to grow up in a family with the distillery or in the business. So, but it was always something that I was very interested in. And my mom was very much a historian for her side of the family, which was J.W. Dant,
mm-hmm.
and made sure that we were aware of who J.W. Dant was, and she was very adamant about that. And all the Dants were very proud of their heritage,
mm-hmm.
And so she was. There was an article the other day about Maker's Mark and tourism, you know, and how Maker's Mark when they first mm-hmm. toured. And I remember when that opened up, you know, that was one of the first. Mom was like, "We need to go out there," so we went out and toured Maker's Mark right when they first opened up, just to show what her interest in the distilling business. So
mm-hmm.
Really much more than the my dad and the Beam side.
Mm-hmm. That's pretty cool. I mean, you think about Maker's Mark. We were just at the Old Samuels Distillery today, and you can name a Beam that worked at the Old Samuels, a Beam that worked at Maker's Mark. I mean, it was just like, you know, we were looking through all that, and you talk about Joe's sons. They were all over the place, even in Canada.
Right.
And
Mexico.
In Mexico. Joseph L. Yeah.
Which ties back in with your Rippey.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. Yeah. We talk about it in Lawrenceburg, you know, with Mary Dowling and the water film Frasier.
Right.
We talk about that. And, you know, so they went north and south of the border to distill during Prohibition.
And, you know, I just read, and it was a Pottinger, and he was recalling history. And he mentioned, and it's the first I've heard, but he said his father, watch them disassemble the distillery in Gethsemane and send it to Canada. Now, I had not heard that. I know the story that going to Mexico mm-hmm. is well known, but I've not heard the one go to Canada. Now, I know my grandfather went to Canada.
He went with the Waffle? Was it the Waffle family?
Right. Okay. And I don't know if they actually disassembled the he, in this recollection, says that his father watched them load the distillery on train cars in Gethsemane and take it to Canada.
And we heard through your tour, which was awesome, that he stayed there 13 years by himself.
Yeah. All the prohibitions. He came back and forth. And, my dad, was born after one of his trips. Okay.
Your dad was in the distillery with him, but he was kind of known for something else that he was in.
Yeah, he was. He and his brother Toddy, Walter Toddy, were really good baseball players. And so there, the time back, in the 30s and 40s, they had the old bourbon leagues. Mm-hmm. So each distillery would have its own ball team, and they were quite competitive. And I always joke, I said, you see these brands going from one distillery to the other distillery. And so that was probably either a card game or the ball game.
Something like that. Yeah.
So which distillery did he play for at that time?
He started at the distillery in Athertonville.
Okay.
And then he was hired away.
Uh-oh.
By, I think that he said he paid he and Toddy 25 cents an hour more. And they went to work for the Loretta Distillery. Okay. And which is, if you're familiar with the warehouses in Loretta, right in near downtown Loretta, okay. That was where the old Loretta Distillery was. There's one of the old original warehouses there.
Okay.
Near the big water tank for the fire,
Cool. So he actually worked at distillery too, though.
Yes.
So when he did that, so.
But back then it was a seasonal job, more or less.
Okay.
Because they would shut down, and all the distilleries would shut down pretty much in the summertime. The water pretty much dried up a lot of times, mm-hmm. and the heat, and so they would shut down. So he needed something more stable than that because he wasn't a farmer, so he moved on.
So you said your mom got you back into this.
Yes.
So was she still alive whenever they opened?
Oh yes, yes.
Okay. What did she say?
Oh, she was thrilled. but she always did. She always did make sure. She says, "You talk about those beans an awful lot. You make sure you
talk about the beans."
50-50.
Oh, wait a minute. That's a pretty good lady.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we talked about the dance, which would be your cousins. Kind of.
Well, it is.
I know it's difficult.
It sounds a lot worse than it is.
He's my uncle out there, man.
But Mike Dant, who was my grandmother's first cousin, ended up marrying my grandmother on the other side, sister. So we kind of became intertwined that way.
Okay.
So Mary Birch, her sister Cora Birch, married Mike Dant, and then that was my other grandmother's cousin. So.
And the Dant's been since 1830s.
1836.
Yeah, producing. Yeah. So that's too long.
Yeah, they got started a little late.
Oh, yeah.
A little late. So I mean, so you've got this now, and you and Paul, and,
right?
And so this is your lineup.
Right.
Of great stuff, and you see this. You see a lot of the labels are, there's history in these labels.
Right.
From your family.
Well, you were even telling me that's his original. It's Minor Case's original emblem that he had on. His.
Right, and if you look closely, it's MCB.
Mm-hmm.
Minor Case.
Oh, yeah, see what you did.
Of course, for obvious reasons, we don't include the beam on the on the bottle. But when I got back into the business, and actually it was a dream from when I was younger, mm-hmm. is to be able to bring back one of the labels into the family, and it was. I always felt like, our story kind of stopped shortly after Prohibition,
right. mm-hmm.
and although my grandfather's actually in the business until the early 60s, late 50s, early 60s.
Yeah.
But we had pretty much, by the time I was around, our family was out of it, but I didn't feel like it should be finished quite yet. So, to be able to use and bring the Yellowstone brand back, which was actually both sides of the family,
mm-hmm.
The Beams and the Dance
right.
were involved in Yellowstone. And it was just
a great fit.
So what of the rest of the Beam family, so the Beams associated with, Jim Beam, and the ones that were associated with Heaven Hill, I mean,
right.
they,
Well, Joe Elbein was one of the original incorporators of Heaven Hill. And he was there for a little while. And Guy worked at Heaven Hill. And so I think Harry did. But anyway, several of them worked there. And they had a disagreement. And Joe left. And that's when Earl, Parker's father, came.
Yeah, we were doing that line. I was like, okay, now we got to jump all the way over. We got to jump up. We're in the Joe set. Then we got to jump all the way over.
So they came off the David line. So they're the same as, you know, Fred Noe and Booker Noe and all that. They come off of that group.
Have they been supportive, though, with you?
Very supportive.
Have they?
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
That's good.
Jim Beam was our sponsor when we joined the craft tour, you know, the Bourbon Trail.
And you're one of the originals of the
trail. Yes, we were one of the original founders of that. It's been great. You know.
Oh, what is it up to 20 on it now?
And counting. It's probably it's probably changing as we speak.
Yeah, now it used to. It was just a little book. Now it's like an actual little stave. And you get a little a medallion for each region.
Yeah.
So I'm sure that's great to get people to come out. Because like I said, when we came here, you know, we were just starting. My wife and I did the craft trail. And we came here and we loved it here. Like I said, when you meet Stephen Fonte, and he gives you a tour, it's easy to love fall in love with the place. And it's like I said, you signed a bottle that we had bought when we first came here, and I love, just what you do with these. And so what's like ahead now for everything that you're looking at? One.
Well, our next will be our bottled and bond. Mm-hmm. You know, right now, we're using source from our partner Luxco, who has Lux Row now over in Bardstown. And the Yellowstone Select is a blend of ours and source. So we're either blending or using source. And so as we move forward, our bottled and bond will be, our distillate, which is the next round.
So you said that comes out next year?
Yes. It should be out the end of next year, beginning of 2022. And then after that, we've got the weeded recipe that comes out as well, but that's probably about 4 years off. And it's the old, an old Dant recipe that I found, and it's 28% wheat, which is a really high wheat content. 28% wheat, 12% malt, and 60% corn.
I really like that part. That, that's kind of the reason we kind of do this is, it's called Behind the Label, because we want to try to inform people of the history sort of that goes with this. And that's exactly the kind of thing that I really like, is that you're taking something that's rooted not only in history but your family's history, and bringing that forward and then doing something positive with it. I really like that. That's a good story.
And of course, our bottled and bond is be 6 year bottled and bond. So you can,
it's not the standard 4 yet.
Right. You do the standard 4, but ours is going to be a 6 year bottled and bond.
And I know the Yellowstone label itself went out of the family. How hard was it to get back into the family?
Well, with the partnership with Luxco, it came back into Limestone Branch, and so it worked out well.
So they owned it at the time. Yeah.
So it was originally sold out of the Dant family in 1944, and then it went to Glenmore, the Thompson family.
Is that in Owensboro?
Yes. But they bought the Yellowstone plant in Louisville, which actually became their main focus. That was their best selling. That was their flagship, was Yellowstone. And then it became the best-selling bourbon in Kentucky in the 1960s and 70s.
Yeah.
One third of all the bourbon sold in Kentucky was Yellowstone, which is crazy.
That's a lot. That's a lot. A lot. Now you say Beam does that, but that's their whole line.
Yeah. So.
It's just one bottle. Right?
Yeah. And then it was the Thompson sold it to United Distillers, which was kind of grouping a lot of the old distilleries and labels up, buying them up. But then they merged with Guinness, became Diageo, and the Brits said, "What is this? What is this bourbon stuff? We don't want to be bothered with this stuff." So they closed the distillery down and sold off all the brands. Except I think they kept Bullet, but they sold. That's when Heaven Hill got Old Fitzgerald and J.W. Dant and T.W. Samuels, a lot of the old United Distiller labels, and Luxco got Yellowstone, Ezra Brooks, David Nicholson, Rebel Yell. So that all came in that, and that was in the early 90s.
One thing nice about this though is this label is, like I said, it's historic, but this is a premium bourbon now.
Right.
A lot of those old ones that were like historic are what you find on the bottom shelf now.
Well, you know, Yellowstone kind of went through that, you know, as bourbon fell from grace in the 80s and 90s, you know, it became a bottom shelf, and then we brought it back into the family. I reformulated to what it is now, and you know, we were able to raise it up.
Yeah.
I lost my train of thought. So go ahead.
I was gonna say it's kind of like the Four Roses story, you know, where they kind of crashed out, and now they, you know, brought back some premium stuff.
Yeah, they intentionally crashed out though.
Oh, was that a move on their part?
Yeah, they sent all the bourbon overseas.
Right,
and
turned Japan.
Yeah, everything in the United States was just a whiskey. So they intentionally did that. But the thing is, it's kind of funny. This was started from the First National Park, the name. But there's a show out now where you see this now on there.
Right.
So
we advertise on the show.
Yeah. That has to be.
Does the bottle actually show up on the show, or just advertise during?
No. But we do advertise on the show. And it's been great, you know, it's really helped. And that's great for the parks as well, because, you know, we donate a portion of the bottle sales back to the National Parks Conservation Association. So people are able to help support the parks. We've donated, you know, over $100,000 in the last couple of years back to the parks. So
Need it these days. Any of the national parks, they need it. I mean, they're not having it easy right now. So it's, you know, everything's hard on everybody right now, especially the parks. And, but I think this is great that, you know, Paul brought all this back, and, you know, two prestigious bourbon families combined into one now. So, I mean, your last name is Bean, but you're just as much Dant as you are Bean.
Yeah,
and your mom was definitely, she's probably saying more Dant than me.
His mom probably said, no, he's all Dant.
Yeah. So
it's funny because Wally over at the new distillery, Wally Dant, and I joke all the time because I say, if I ever need a kidney, I know where to come. Because other than my father and his mother, we have the same genes. I mean, it was because brother and sister married, you know, the brother's sister married the brother. So his grandmother is my grandfather's brother, and his grandmother is my grandmother's brother, sister. But the brothers and sisters marry each other, you know. We have the same, you know, genes in our grandparents on back.
We have that in Eastern Kentucky.
Yeah.
You know, my family is that way. I come from a huge family. You know, my mom was one of 16.
Yeah.
So there was half the family married, seemed like brothers.
Yeah, you go to Rolton and everybody's, related there, literally everybody.
Everybody.
In that end of the county.
So Eastern Kentucky distilling family is pretty close. We went through that in Lawrenceburg, like, you know, we're talking to Mr. Rippey, it's like all the families are related.
Yeah.
So I guess you pretty much, because you ran in the same circles.
Right.
And everything.
Yeah, it was either through business or marriage, all the big bourbon, especially the historical ones, are all just like that.
And you know, and especially kind of this area, I mean, it's a little bit different when you get over to Louisville and up Lexington, but, you know, this part of Kentucky, you know, I mean, you look at, a lot of people don't realize there was, you know, Jacob Bean, and there was a Jacob Jr. Nobody ever talks about Jacob Jr.
Never.
I found about him when I was looking, you know, through old grave sites and things, and there was a David Weller Bean. And I was like, who is David Weller Bean? So, comes to find out, Jacob Jr., so you had Jacob Jr., married into the Weller family.
Wow, I didn't know that.
and David Weller Bean was their son. Yeah.
You just don't hear about Jacob because he wasn't in distilling. So
right.
Yeah.
But he was in the distilling. He, you know, he went off with the Wellers who were record buyers.
Married into it.
He stayed in it. But you just don't hear about that whole section of the family at all.
So growing up, sounds like your mom was definitely, you know, kind of family proud with the dance. How much did bourbon itself, the drink, was it something that was like just on every shelf in your house?
It was always around.
Okay.
Yeah. And at every, you know, function, there was always a bourbon and Yellowstone, you know, because it had recently been out of the family. So we always had a bottle of Jim Beam because my dad's name was Jim. We always had a bottle of Jim Beam and a bottle of Yellowstone. And but I remember Yellowstone for tea. My mom used it on my niece for teething.
Oh yeah,
For hot toddies when you had a cough. And I guess it was late at night, and my mom did, but they weren't very good. Especially when you're young, it kept me from drinking
medicine.
Yeah, it kept me from drinking bourbon for a while.
My next question was that something that where you were tasting bourbon when you were 14, and you're like, that's good bourbon or that's bad bourbon, or at what point in your life did you kind of
First, was 21 and started drinking. My first drink was a 7 and 7. That's what. My dad said my grandfather rolled over in his grave.
Yes!
Taking that swill.
And then Makers, I drank had some Makers, and I was like, no.
You got bourbon lures you in. Yeah.
I can drink this, mm-hmm. And so that's Makers was actually the first bourbon that I really started drinking.
That's one of your.
Yeah, I was gonna say that's kind of how I got, because of the weed, because mm-hmm. it was just easier to, where it wasn't that this tastes like cough medicine or something.
Right.
Because some of that stuff, especially when you're young, you taste a little bit here and there, and you're just like, how do people bring that? Yeah. But then, the weed and stuff kind of got me in a little more and more, and Jerry's trying to get on the more on the rye base.
Well, I think the weed is like kind of a step up from Tennessee whiskey, because to me, it's real sweet. And then you go into weeded. So I tell them it's the way to kind of move you up.
Yeah. Now I prefer a heavier rye.
Do you like a high rye? Yeah. But I like a rye whiskey. So, I love this.
Yeah. I like that.
I love that. It's finished, finished in the sherry cask. Yeah.
And that's it's a funny thing about that. It's an American, all American product because it's a cream sherry. It's an American cream sherry. So it's not an imported sherry cask. It's from Myers Winery in Cincinnati, which is Cincinnati's oldest winery, and people think of, what does that region know about wine? But that the first commercial winery in the United States was in Kentucky.
Here,
down there in
Nicholasville,
south of Nicholasville.
Yeah, they're great down there. We go down there all the time. The First Vineyard.
Yeah.
Appropriate name.
So so the region has a history of that. So this and the sherry, the Myers Cream Sherry 44, is aged in ex-bourbon barrels. So they take the sherry, age it in ex-bourbon barrels,
and then
they dump it, and then we finish our rye.
Well, no wonder it tastes so good.
Yeah, so it's just a completed circle.
No wonder it tastes so good. No, that's good stuff.
And you've kind of even finished your Yellowstone.
We do, each year we do a limited edition, and each year is a different expression. So sometimes we do finished. Sometimes we do just a straight bourbon.
Mm-hmm.
Last year was a 9-year straight bourbon whiskey. This year we finished it in an Armagnac cask. And but just like with the minor case rye, I don't like a really heavily finish. I don't want it to be all about the cream sherry mm-hmm. or the Armagnac. I want it to be a bourbon, and those notes from the Armagnac just complement the bourbon. That's what I'm shooting.
You've done a good job with that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, awesome. Now, how does that inspiration come to you? Do you think about that all year? Think, what am I going to do this coming year? Or is it like we had one night, the night
well,
before, you're like,
oh, we look out there and see what casks are available, and then I choose the different casks, and so that's kind of where we're at. Yeah, and I knew Armagnac has some similar notes to bourbon to begin with. And so I thought it would work really well, and I think it did.
It's Armagnac, so it's kind of like a refined brandy, I guess.
It's similar to a cognac.
Cognac, okay.
Yeah, it's actually a little bit older spirit than cognac, and it's not distilled quite as much, and I think that you can use a few more varieties of grapes in the Armagnac.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so I didn't understand that. I knew cognac come from like a certain region.
Right, and so does Armagnac.
It comes from a certain region also. Yeah. Okay, that's cool.
Now, how long did it take you to refine your palate, basically, where you can, taste all this different stuff? Like you said, you have different notes.
I'm sure the Bean family reunion is probably involved.
I make and blend what I like. And so I hope that there's enough people out there that like what I do, and so far there, it seems to be. And so that's really the way I do things. And so it is what it is, you know?
I like that. That's definitely the art end of it.
Right.
Yeah, I like
it. And it's not for everybody, you know, not everybody's gonna like exactly what I like, and that's fine. That's why there's, you know, a whole section of bourbon on the grill. But, you know, the people who do like that, then they know that anything that's coming out of here that they're probably gonna like, because mm-hmm. it's gonna be of a profile that they like mm-hmm. somewhere.
Well, we just wanna thank you for having us out and stuff, and we love, you know, we always talk about, you know, everybody comes here and they wanna see Maker, or they wanna see Jim Beam, they wanna see Woodford Reserve, but they're missing out if they don't stop at places like yours.
Right.
I mean, they're missing out. Just between the great bourbon around stuff, is they're missing out on the history, all of that, and getting to meet people that are, you know, you get so big, sometimes I think some of these places may lose a little bit of heart.
Yeah.
And you all, the craft distillers, are putting your heart and sweating these bottles every day.
That is for sure. Yeah. You know, the big guys do a great job, and mm-hmm. Everybody on the bourbon trail and the mm-hmm. Kentucky Bourbon Craft Trail has really stepped their games
they
up,
have,
you know, and make for a great visitor experience. So I don't think anybody's going to have a bad time, no matter where they go.
No.
But, you know, the crafts are a little bit smaller and a little bit more intimate, generally.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I think it's great if you can work it in. I mean, we have a tour where we start with you all, and we do Heaven Hill and Jim Beam. Right. But we like to show people that you know, craft what we call artisanal bourbon, artisan bourbon, on our tour, so people can see that it's not just these big, huge column stills that are producing these, you know, so many hundred barrels a day or whatever. That there's other ways that you can go about it and make great products.
Well, yeah, and then have a great drink.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, one thing, when people come here, you know, we do everything in the one room, so mm-hmm. people, it makes sense, it clicks, I can see it clicking in people's heads, you mm-hmm. know, exactly the process. Sometimes it's a little difficult to understand the process, you know, when it's separated out, you know, like mm-hmm. a whole room of fermenters, and then, you know, you don't really understand how that process works.
Especially if you're taking a shuttle from one place to the next.
Right, yeah. But here, you know, you see the, you know, the fermenters, and they go into mm-hmm. this still, and then we distill that, and then the, you know, the low wine goes over here, and then it goes in, you know, the barrel. So everything is right there, concise, you know.
Mm-hmm. We just like to really appreciate it. Yep. It's a great place to come out and visit. I mean, definitely, you know, if you're out on the bourbon trail, just check that little craft bourbon trail,
right,
and visit some great distilleries along the way.
Yeah.
So thank you very much.
Oh, yeah, you're welcome. Really anytime. You're always welcome, and we're open every day. People want to come out 7 days a week, mm-hmm. about 360 days a year.
And they just find you online right now. Your website and everything.
Yes.
It's all online. Everything pretty much with this going on is all
right.
Yeah.
Online, and people can you can book tours online. Everything online.
Well, thank you.
All right. Yep. Thanks, guys.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Drinking dark whiskey, telling white lies. One leads to another.